And I laughed. I said to him, I bet when you were with your brother who owned a hot bar in New York, people would come and they say, and what do you do? And before you had the words out, I'm a teacher, they had left.
Right. Are you talking about Frank McCourt?
Yes.
He actually lived in my apartment building in New York.
Yeah.
When I was living on my own and had my first place in New York, he lived in the same building, and I would see him, and it was always very inspiring because I always wanted to be a writer, and just to know that this great writer was living two floors below me was kind of amazing.
But truly, his brother had been had been on Johnny Carson's, and Frank was he was a watcher.
Yes, yes, but I think the watchers are the people who turn into writers.
Yeah.
And he's a great example because his success came later in life.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we're all so consumed with this idea that you have to be successful young.
Yeah, doing it early.
Yes, and I think with writing, that's not necessarily how it always plays out. Because it takes years, I think, to really learn how to write and then to have something to write about.
Right.
And to have some perspective too, if you are writing about your own life, to have some perspective on it so that you can you can write about it.
What else have you written, Joanna?
Well, these are my first books. I moved out to LA to write for television.
Mm-hmm.
I was writing fiction before that in New York, but I was working on a novel and it wasn't really going anywhere. And my sister, we're very close in age. She's 18 months younger than me. She had moved out here years before and had become a very successful television writer. And so she suggested that I write a television spec, mm-hmm. and I did, and I got an agent. And so I wrote on a show called Las Vegas when I first lived here.
How long?
One season.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a fantastic learning experience. And
yeah.
I think writing for television actually taught me about structure, taught me about plot. So much has to happen in a show, and when you've got commercials as well. And the plot has to keep moving. And I think I applied a lot of what I learned to this series in terms of pacing and structure and plot.
Had you majored in English literature?
I did. I majored in English. I went to Brown, and I did not take any creative writing classes there, which I regret, but I always wanted to be a writer. I think I just didn't know how to do it. And when you're in your 20s and you're out of school and you've got to support yourself and get out there and start working, I thought, well, that's probably a pipe dream. That's probably not going to happen for me. So I'm going to be responsible and get my full-time job and so on. And but I've learned that your dream kind of comes back to haunt you.
Yeah. And when you went to Notre Dame?
I went to Notre Dame. I went there for law school, and that's really when I think I decided, if I keep going down this path, I mean, I loved law school, but I thought, I really truly want to be a writer in my heart.
Yeah.
And I know if I keep going down this path, that's where I'm going to end up being a lawyer, and I'm just going to put off the inevitable.
Mm-hmm.
So I started taking writing classes at Notre Dame.
Yeah.
And I finished my law degree, but I got into an MFA program in creative writing at Notre Dame.
Yeah.
So by the time I left there, I kind of neatly segued into the writing world. Of course, my parents were a little surprised, but they've always been very supportive. And that's when I started writing seriously. And that was about 10 years ago that I started that program.
What's interesting is that if you worked for Las Vegas writing those, you had a lot of characters. It wasn't just straight one line. There was always something going on where you had to keep keeping the balloons in space.
Yes, yes. And I think there were times when before I moved out here, when I was in New York and I was really, I was living a very monastic life in New York. I was writing constantly. I would stay home every night and every weekend, and I finally got a part-time job at a bookstore, and there were moments when I thought, you know, what if this doesn't pan out? And you really, you have to be very persistent. And the television writing was a bridge. You know, it was, it got me into a new city. Yeah. It got me around a lot of other writers, which was, I think, which is great about Los Angeles. Yeah. I mean, everyone's a writer in LA. And it taught me, again, it taught me sort of the mechanics of writing. And when I returned to fiction, I got the idea for this series 10 years ago, but I was afraid of it. I didn't want to write about myself or being the daughter of someone famous. I was trying to do everything I could to get away from that. And when I returned to it finally, I was more comfortable with the material. I was older. Yeah. And I knew how to outline it. Yeah. I knew how to actually structure these books.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you're leaving me also here with what Hudson, I assume she's the heroine of The Daughter, what is it?
The Daughters Take the Stage.
Takes the Stage.
Yes, that's the next book, which will come out in May. And I did leave the first two books on a bit of a cliffhanger. Yeah. I apologize for that. It's the TV writer in me. Yeah. But yes, she will be the lead character of the next book, and she's the daughter of a pop star. And
but you've done interesting. Hudson can sing.
Yes.
But her mother is shaping her into like a little me. And has gotten her the man who is grooming the record and all of that to the tunes, and it's not the real Hudson.
Right.
So when, as a favor to see who's put her into this spot, stand up and entertain people your own age, your friends, that's a horrible situation to be in.
Yes, yes. And I don't want to give anything away, but we leave... at the end of this book, we leave Hudson about to walk out on stage to perform for this Christmas dance. And Karina, her friend, has volunteered her without asking Hudson her permission. And her, we've gotten the sense that she's very nervous about it. And so I don't want to give away exactly what happens, but she has to really deal with, do I want to be famous like my mom? That kind of famous.
Yeah.
And what's, I know I'm talented, how do I take control of that for myself?
So. Each of the girls so far does not want to be a cookie cutter version of their parent.
Right.
I mean, they're going to have even C, who I call her C because that's what her friends call her.
Karina.
Karina. She's smart. She knows how to organize, but she doesn't want to go into her father's company and be, you know, counting the nickels.
Yes.
On the other hand, when she's offered Princess Magazine, you can see her eyes clicking. This would be perfect, as she's telling the editor what's wrong with the magazine.
Right. She actually does have some of her dad's business acumen. Yeah. And she, I think, realizes that by the end of the book, but she doesn't quite want to embrace it yet. And I think that that's a universal theme to adolescence. You don't want to mirror your parents in any way when you're that age. You really want to find your own identity.
Joanna, it's a terrific book. And
I must say,
as I said, I know it's for sort of younger people, but I enjoyed it thoroughly.
Oh, I'm so glad. Yeah. Thank you so much.
And including the first with the dress designer.
Thank you. I'm so pleased that you liked it, Pompani.
And thank you very much. Will you autograph my
book? I would love to.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, I'll tell you a terrific book, The True Memoirs of Little Kay, Adrienne Steele, Sharp, excuse me. And this is about the dancer who became the mistress of the last Tsar of Russia. Now, I had just done a book on St. Petersburg, and I had seen this gorgeous villa, castle. And he said to me as I'm looking at it, that was the home of Kay, Little Kay, she was called. and the Tsar had built it for her. Well, this is how and why he did the building from the author's point of view. She was the daughter of a dancer and the whole family, but she also had a relative who had been royalty in Poland. And the only clue to it had been a ring that she cannot find, because the Tsar could not marry her. She was a commoner. And this is what happened during the revolution and with the son of the Tsar that she produced. Well, it's a good book. And meanwhile, support your local library. Go in, take out a card. Libraries are our finest democratic institutions. I have been saying it forever. But the person you really should thank is the librarian. The librarian, he or she, are truly the unsung heroes of America. They are the ones who are helping keep libraries open, helping your child to read, helping your grandparent to read better because they have large print books. Well, anyhow, libraries are the part of America you should be definitely supporting, keeping the doors open. What did a library mean to you growing up?
Oh, I love libraries. In fact, I think the only other job I'd really want would be a librarian. I go to the Beverly Hills Library here because I used to live very close to it, yeah. And I use it all the time. It's a fantastic, fantastic resource.
And if you have books you're not using, or books you've read and don't care to keep, donate them. The library can absolutely use them. Meanwhile, let me know what you've been reading. I'm at www.conniemartinson.com or email me at talksbooks@lycos.com. You'll be able to see on YouTube at least 80 of our shows. And if you go to Claremont Graduate University, Peter Drucker Institute, they have digitized over 600 of our past programs. So, wherever you go, there we are, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Connie.